Welcome to Day 2 Cloud. Today we're talking about recruiters. And I know, right, Ethan? We're going to talk to a recruiter, but don't turn off that station. It's good. It's a really interesting conversation with Taylor Desseyn. He's the senior recruiter advocate at Vaco. And it's just, I've dealt with a lot of recruiters, and this was not what I expected at all. So, Ethan, what stuck out to you in this episode?
Well, like you, I've worked with my share of recruiters over my career and have had my share of bad experiences. Just felt like a piece of meat in their grist mill trying to, you know, get me matched up with a job to move on next, meet the numbers. And Taylor points out in the show that it doesn't have to be like that and explains how to find a recruiter that's more on your side. I learned a lot listening to him. I love the show.
Yeah, it was absolutely fascinating. So I'm not going to belabor the point. Enjoy this episode with Taylor Desseyn, senior recruiter advocate at Vaco. Taylor, welcome to the show. If I could just get you to first summarize technical recruiting, let's start there and then expand out.
Yeah, so technical recruiting again, Ned, Ethan, thanks for having me on. I will tell you, technical recruiting as a whole is defined as a mess.
Would you describe it as a hot mess?
It truly is. It truly is a hot mess. I mean, no, I think technical recruiting, especially in today's world, has been flipped on its head, right? I think what's happened is that for the longest time, recruiters were so focused on DMing people time and time again in their local markets, typically, right? Because like the company I work at, Vaco, we're very siloed to our own cities, right? So previously to COVID, I recruited engineers in Nashville. And then now COVID flipped on its head and we went totally across the country now, right? And so I think to describe technical recruiting right now in today's world, it is ever evolving and is quickly evolving. And I will tell you this, the good ones are rising to the top very fast and the bad ones are doing the complete opposite very, very fast.
Interesting. So do you think that's because now you're playing to a national audience and so people can be more selective of the recruiter they work with?
100%. Yeah, because I mean, let's face it, you can be in Montana and now get called by every single recruiter instead of probably like three or four. Right. Because now if you're in Montana, you probably have a skill set that you probably know about that is very technical and is very in demand. So you probably moved to Montana because you knew that it can be done remote, period, pre-pandemic. Right. I was working with a Scala engineer in Montana. Right. He's in Montana. Scala's in demand. He's going to be able to work remote pre-pandemic. Now you have Brian Smith in the south of Tennessee getting called by 90 recruiters for a .NET technical skill set that used to be just, you know, he could get a job here in town. Now he's getting called across the country. So it just is, it's been flipped on its head. Technical recruiting has been flipped on its head. If you're not trying to learn and trying to get better and trying to help yourself and increase brand, which if we want to get into, we can. The importance of that right now in a totally digital workforce, I think you're going to lose.
Wow. Okay. No, I'm going to be honest. I'm going to be upfront. I haven't had the best experience with recruiters. And I might be describing some other people's experience. I'm never entirely certain they've got my best interests at heart. Sure. And they also really often slide into my LinkedIn DMs with jobs that I'm either totally unqualified for, or it's like some random thing on my resume from 10 years ago. So what's up with that? What's going
Ned,
on?
Ned, you got to take that cold fusion off of your LinkedIn from 10 years ago, man. I've told you that time and time again. You know, for me, so I get this question a lot, right? It's this, why are recruiters DMing me? Are they not even reading? Are they not even taking the time out? And for the listeners who are listening to this, like, I'm going to answer your question right now. No, they're not taking the time out. Right? Us as recruiters, we are responsible for hitting metrics, right? At the end of the day, the reason why the recruiting industry is broken is because you try to put metrics on people and that doesn't work. And so what happens is you DM, and you're just like, hey, templated message. And then, cause here's the deal, Ned, even though you have done cold fusion 10, 15 years ago, and you don't want to work the role, the recruiter's going to cover 100, you know, 200 people in a day, and five people are going to probably get back to that person, right? It's mm-hmm. not necessarily about relationship building. That's what I'm saying from the question beforehand of what's technical recruiting right now. It's a hot mess because the massive DMs have probably escalated, but it's also causing those individuals to like really hurt themselves. And so the reason why we message is because my team doesn't, right? I manage a team of 9 recruiters. I make sure that we try to really focus on the human aspect of recruiting. But for me, like we try to take more into account of like, hey, how many quality people are you meeting a week, right? So my team, I want us to meet at least 8 people a week, right? A lot of other recruiting firms are like, you need to talk to 15 to 20 a week. So when that happens, you're going to get the DMs in your inbox that are just ridiculous.
So how are you finding these people then? If you've got this, like you said, if your metrics driven because that's how you're measured on whether you're doing your job or not, are you even looking like manually at LinkedIn profiles or resumes? No, or are you using like DM. A keyword search?
Keyword search, baby. Control F all day. And here's the deal, right? I used to be the recruiter that we're talking about. I started at Vaco 9 years ago, almost 10 years ago at this point, which is crazy to think about. I moved up to Nashville to do music like everyone else and realized I was serving tables 6 nights a week and losing money, not playing any money or not playing any gigs. So, but when I started, I just didn't know any better, right? I think the issue with recruiting these days is that there's not an emphasis of training, right? While Vaco has gotten better training, we are still not there. And I think you could talk to anybody at Vaco and they could admit to that. And so I think we're trying to get better. But what happens is sales organizations try so hard to push. They don't realize that sometimes slowing down to speed up is going to be your greatest strength.
Well, who's even your customer? Let me put it this way. I have had lots of jobs over the year in tech, but most of those have come word of mouth. That is, I knew someone or I was sure. at an event and got talking and so on and kind of found out about an opportunity and it went from there. I haven't really worked with recruiters other than a time or two. So is your recruiter someone like me, a technologist, or is your customer a company who's trying to fill a position?
Yeah, so this is a good question. So I'm gonna kind of break it down kind of in a few ways, right? So first off, I told my boss, my coworker, that listen, I want to hire individuals who are fun to be around, who have high EQ, and who have no experience recruiting.
Now, interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
So a lot of people are gonna listen. It's like, okay, your team must be terrible. Actually, we're not. I would say we have the best recruiting team in the country at Vaco. And here is why. Because what happens is I have sat down, I've personally sat down with each recruiter and have trained them. Hey, what does the UI look like? Right. What is the back end? Right. What tech goes where? Let's break down the SDLC. Right. I think a lot of times recruiters are just like, hey, I need a .NET developer and let's search .NET. Let's be honest. There's so many flavors of .NET, even within .NET Core at this point, right? And so then you have to search like, you know, do you need a web forms or do you need win forms? Like, what are you doing, right? And it's like, there's no training from that perspective. Now, so let's put that there and let's answer Ethan's second question about like, who's calling us? How does all that work, right? So how does that work? That works by usually companies who can't find the jobs after 30 days, they then call us.
Mm.
So they are already have internal HR and their internal development teams trying to tap the referrals before we even get the job order. And then it's our responsibility to frantically, I'm telling you, like it is like, so I don't know if any of y'all served tables at all growing up.
I did.
Yeah. I served tables. You know how like it's in the middle of the shift and somebody brings back some food that was like given to the staff or like a cake that was like someone's birthday and it was like given and like it's like vultures. Like it's like mm-hmm. it's like no one's ever seen food before. That's the exact same way it is with the recruiting team when we get a new job order because it's like, oh my gosh, like whoever's given it to us has already had a chance to obviously tap their network. And so and then it takes us spinning our wheels, hence the massive amount of DMs. Because of the fact that we're already getting to job orders 30 days late.
But you can't just be looking to LinkedIn raw, right? You've got to be digging through a database of your own that you guys have built.
We do. And that's why, so one of the things I'm really, really big on with job seekers and how to vet recruiters, that's what I've been really loud on with social media lately, is like, how do you vet a recruiter, right? We vet jobs as a job seeker. We're like, okay, what, we don't like this job because of this reason. And we don't like, you know what I'm saying? We ask questions, we go to the interview and prepared and we ask questions. You talk to a recruiter and you're just like, yeah, sounds good. Right. Mm-hmm. And it's like, no, nobody vets a recruiter. And so I've been very loud on like, hey, how do you really like focus on, you know, what questions to ask a recruiter? And the biggest thing that I talk about is see how long that recruiter has been doing their job. Because the reason is because they have a bigger book of business. Right. So the typical recruiter, going to Ethan's question, I'm a little long winded sometimes. To answer right. Ethan's question,
all good, man.
The typical recruiter meets around 500 to 700 people a year.
Wow.
Okay.
A year.
Yep.
So extrapolate that where I'm at, 10 years. Yep. You see, so if you're a job seeker and you meet anybody, now I said this 2 years back and I got a lot of kickback from my team because my team was young at the time. I said, don't work with any recruiter under 2 years. And most of my recruiting team was under 2 years. I heard about that. So, but the thing is though, the reason why I say that is because I didn't really even know the city of Nashville. So I like started in Nashville, then I moved to Raleigh and it was in the Research Triangle area for a year and then moved back to Nashville. Mm-hmm. And like when I was in Raleigh for a year, like so many good connections, love those guys and girls out there that I've made friends with, still in touch with a lot of them. But when it comes to like knowing your network and knowing the companies in town, it takes time. No right. recruiter under 2 years, in my opinion, can be super effective in being an advocate for you.
So it sounds like most of your customers are then the companies, but if I'm on the other end looking for a job and I ring up Taylor, do you work for me as well?
So yes and no. So there's two sides to this. And again, great question, Ethan. I appreciate this a ton. And so we're uncovering some goodness in this and I love it so much. So you have the clients who call us, right? So our job as recruiters is to be proactive, right? So we're talking about the 10 to 15 to 20 people a week, industry average, you know, we're extrapolating that out over a year, 2 years. Cause what we try to do is we try to build this entire network, right? So like, let's say Ned calls me tomorrow and goes, hey, I need a cloud guy or girl. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be like, okay, Ned, well, first off, what platform are you using? Right. Most recruiters won't even ask that. Like, sure, I'll go get cloud. I'll go get a cloud guy or girl.
All
like,
the clouds. No.
Y'all, all of it. It's all the same. So we do that. But so for us is like, I want to bring, so if Ned calls me tomorrow for an Azure resource and I'm going to go to the people, the 5 to 10 people that I've met in the last 6 months who have touched Azure. And then we go, all right, Ned, what's Azure's big? What specific functionality are you looking for? Okay, well, we need serverless functions, durable functions, all that stuff, right? Okay, great. Then I go back to my 10 people. I'm like, hey, 10 people, who has durable functions? You, two people have it? Okay, great. Hey, Ned, here are my two people who have durable functions. You want to talk to them? So that's how that works, right? So what we do is we try to build this entire network of people and we have spreadsheets. We have Excel spreadsheets and things, so we have to keep track of people.
So you don't. So it's more like, hey, Taylor, I'm a resource. I'm kind of on the market and looking. If you happen to run across somebody, hey, make sure I'm in your database so that I'll match when you're looking to fill a position.
Correct. Less database, just more like keep checking in with me so I can have it within like my like notebook or whatnot. But yeah, absolutely. Like for me, I always tell people that the individuals who are not actually looking for a job are best for me because I want to meet everybody. And then let's be, you know, very intentional with what jobs I send you.
Oh, that's very interesting. I want to back up on that because you said you want to talk to people who aren't even looking for jobs.
Sure.
You just want to, want to get to know them. Yep. And then is it going to be a sort of thing where you're constantly checking and be like, hey, you need a job yet? You want a job yet? Or is it more of a, I'll let you know if something crops up I think you might be interested in, or reach out to me when you're ready to look.
Yes. So my thing, and so you brought up a really good point, and I'm really glad because we're going to segue into kind of what what I've been doing the last year and kind of uncovered from a recruiting at scale. And we're going to break down what at scale means from a recruiting perspective, right? Because what I do, what recruiters do, we are like doctors. If you typically don't come to us until what? Something is wrong.
Right. Well, I got laid off from my job and now I desperately need another job.
Something is wrong. But my thing is I want to be, because like selfishly, to be honest with you boys, I'm on this podcast. I want to be on this because I'll tell you this, in 10 years, if Ned or Ethan are wanting to spin up something on their own and need resources, I want y'all to call me. And that's what recruiters don't understand, is that this thing that we do is a lifetime long game.
Mm.
And because, so what I've done in COVID is I basically have completely changed how I do business. So I am not DMing you on LinkedIn anymore. I am not emailing you off Dyson Career Builder. I have a live show, shameless self-plug, Guidance Counselor 2.0. You can check it out. Every single morning I go live and I have guests or talk about various things that I'm dealing with job seekers. Because here's the deal. There are people that I know that aren't looking that watch it every day and DM me. It's like, oh, that was good. That was good. Because you know what's going to happen is when the economy goes back and everyone's comfortable looking for jobs again, who do you think they're going to call? Ghostbusters. Right. No, me.
Right. Unless you start a side business as a Ghostbuster and then
it I'm the biggest scaredy cat. I hate scary movies. So I would be terrible at that job. So it's all about being top of mind, right? Which we're a lot of recruiters understand now because we're totally virtual. That listen, if you're just DMing people day in, day out, like it's only going to get you so far 10 years from now.
Now, does it matter what type of job I'm interested in? Does it matter if I'm looking for full-time work or I want to go contract work or project? But like, does it matter what type of job I'm looking for that I should get with a recruiter, or are there certain types of jobs where it doesn't make sense?
Yeah, I mean, the recruiter should be asking you that, right? Which is another kind of signal indicator thingy. Where you should see if the recruiter's asking you good questions, right? So if I'm going to talk to Ned and I go, hey, Ned, do you want more of the consulting side? Do you want like part-time? Do you want consulting long-term? Or do you want to do direct hire salaried stuff? You know, then Ned goes, well, you know what, Taylor, actually, I'm open to all of it. Okay, great. Well, then Ned goes, you know what, Taylor, I'm only going to bounce for a salary job. I'm in a salary job now. I'm not going to bounce for anything else. Then I'm only going to keep you in mind for salary jobs.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but here's what I've been trying to think of is trying to, and this is, so I've launched another shameless self plug, taylordesseyn.com. What my goal is I'm trying to wrap my arms around the 7,000 people that I've met. And it's like, how do I take all that data, all of it, all those individuals, keep in touch with them? But it's like different levers to pull, right? So it's like, do I keep in touch with the people I've met the last 30 days differently than I've met 4 years ago, right? And it's like, how do you try to focus on keeping in touch and being a human to people when they may not even need you right now, but they may need you 5 years from now? So that's that, you know, if we're talking about, again, the original question, what is technical recruiting? That is what recruiters and individuals should be thinking about for the next 10 years, because in my opinion, we're going to be mainly remote probably from here on out.
Right. One of the things that I was always told when I started my career was you got to build your network. You got to practice good networking. And that always felt very phony, right? You're going to build your network. You're going to go meet these people with the express purpose of broadening your network so you can tap them for something later on. Not because you care about them as an individual. No. You need something in a year and you're going to know that person who can give you that thing. And it always felt very unnatural to me. It sounds like what you're describing is a more natural interaction. Would that be fair to say?
Yeah. So networking, this is another topic I've been really big on over the last year of what is networking? So first off, networking was really, really weird and awkward before the pandemic. Right. Code conferences. I'll tell you what. Listen, I've hung out at the bottom of hotels with y'all nerds a lot. And I'll tell you this. It is awkward. Right. Mm. Like everyone hangs out and clicks. No one really talks. Everyone then talks about like coding. It's just like, man, like a very clicky.
It's right? not what we're good at, Taylor.
It's not. It's so bad. It is so bad. And so what I've done is I've thought about that, and I've tried to be intentional with my messaging during the pandemic, right? So literally right now, if you are still listening to this, how long are we, 20 minutes through? If you are listening to this right now, I want to get this. If there's anything you get out of this entire podcast episode, it's this right here, that networking right now, and probably for a very long time, is liking and commenting on people's statuses.
Hmm. Expand on that.
Yeah, absolutely. So first off, you need to be spending an absurd amount of time on LinkedIn to network. Now, the next question is Taylor, do I need to network? Listen, that is a question that you need to ask yourself. Right. There are some engineers that I know in Nashville and across the country who don't network and who are just fine, who are incredibly technical and who can submit one resume, crush the interview and get the job. But I think as a whole, most of the engineers that I know go to code conferences, are involved in meetups, want to give back. Right. I know a lot of engineers that want to give back. And for me, I think LinkedIn and Twitter, I'm really big on Twitter for networking right now. I had a few people on my live show to talk and break down Twitter right now. But for me, you need to be networking. You need to be getting in the DMs, sliding in the DMs, but also be intentional, right? Hey, Ethan, listen, saw that you run a podcast. I run a podcast. I've had issues with my mic levels recently. How do you do it over Zoom? Well, Taylor, see what I'm saying? And like, that's the way to do it. People are like, hey, Ethan, you need a job? It's like, please stop talking to me. So the DMs, but also too, right? Like, let's say Ned posts the thing about the latest release on Azure or AWS or GCP or whatever, right? You can start commenting and liking that. And that's the equivalent of like a hallway conversation at a code conference.
Now, you're hitting on something here that's, you know, the idea is to first be a person, establish a friendship and a real relationship that's honest. And yeah, eventually at some point, it's something you can trade on, that,
yes,
that relationship that you have. But you can't come in hot with the, I need something from you. Can you give me the thing that I need? Because who wants that? But the trick, Taylor, with this approach is you do have to be genuine. You really do have to find something that's interesting and compelling about that person that makes you, I want to know who that person is. I want to get to know that person. And not have it be the, I'm getting to know you, but it's really kind of fake because someday I'm gonna ask you for a favor.
I know.
Yeah.
You know, I had a gentleman on today on my live show, and he said one thing that really stuck out with me. He goes, the moment that I stopped cold emailing people looking for a transaction and started looking for a relationship, things changed. Mm-hmm. And for me, like, I was so jacked up to be on this with you boys because, like, you guys are my new friends now, right? And like, literally, like you could never call me again for anything, but you post on Twitter, you post on LinkedIn, like I'm going to be all up in those comments. Right. And it's just like, for me, it's like, but the thing with recruiters is that we're so pressured. We are so pressured to hit numbers that, and again, what I'm doing, to be totally transparent, to be totally 100% transparent, it has been so hard for me. And I have felt very imposter syndrome. I have felt very insecure in my business by completely, like, the thought of being on a podcast as part of my job is not accepted in the world of recruiting.
Interesting.
It's not.
I would think that would be an essential part of networking, is getting on podcasts and talking to people. Yeah. And just,
it's not literally many people. And I will tell you this, I've had individuals at Vaco say things sidebar without me not knowing, that's come back to me, that it's like, oh, well, he's not doing, the numbers.
Right. Right.
And it's
right.
Like, go ahead, Ethan.
Well, so I keep thinking about this networking thing. You brought up LinkedIn and Twitter, and you're bringing it up at a time when people are becoming increasingly sensitive to their use of social media and so on because of its addictive nature and all that.
Sure.
You didn't say Facebook. You didn't say Instagram and 20 other networks that you might have mentioned.
I did post a TikTok video, by the way, and it's got 7,000 views overnight. That is wild. We can get into that. But holy smokes. That's another thing. No, I woke up this morning. It was like 200 followers. It's like, what is happening?
Oh, okay.
But let's drill into LinkedIn and Twitter. There's about a thousand things we want to ask you, but let's focus on LinkedIn and Twitter specifically for a minute here. Why did you select those two as most valuable for networking?
Yeah. So again, great question. So for me, I went to school with a guy named Brandon Arve with Brandon 78 out of Lexington, Kentucky. It's a small social media marketing company that he runs. And for the longest time, he was like, I'd love to work with you. I'd love to work with you. And I was like, okay. And finally the pandemic hit. I said, okay, let's work together. and so, you know, he's cut me a crazy deal. He's basically, you know, allowing me to be his kind of like his guinea pig with a lot of platform building and a lot of things that he's trying out for other clients. And he and I've had a ton of conversation around what do we need to focus on right now? And I said, I'm just feeling Twitter, LinkedIn. I'm just feeling it. Now I'm branching out to Instagram now. I'm starting to put more content out on Instagram. And then I'm kind of experimenting with TikTok because I just do so many videos, right? With the podcast and recording the podcast and the live shows and all that. I have so much video content. But when it comes down to it, the reason why I say Twitter and LinkedIn is for two reasons. One, both the organic reach in my mind. And when I say organic reach, I went to school for marketing. I'm not a marketer, right? I don't know what any of this stuff means. I just kind of say things sometimes to make myself sound smart. But the organic reach, AKA being able to find somebody not in your network because they liked something, is like let's say I didn't know Ethan, but Ned and I were connected and Ned liked Ethan's post. I'll know Ethan because Ned liked it. Like that's how crazy Twitter and LinkedIn right now. So I'm going to where the organic reach is the highest. Now, also number two, both are fairly professional. Now you could say Twitter is not professional. You're right. It's not. But the dev community within Twitter is huge. I've met so many developers over Twitter. So I just told my business partner, Brandon, I said, we need to double, triple, quadruple down on Twitter and LinkedIn. And now I'm even thinking about going even deeper on Twitter. Cause then you have the spaces that I got, Clubhouse Rival. Then you have their newsletter feature they're starting to do now. You can actually send newsletters through Twitter to your followers. And then they're talking about like basically Patreon, where you can pay for premium content. So it's like Twitter's finally figuring it out, which is making me realize that like I need to focus on that some more. So that's just high level, right?
Because in LinkedIn, that's pretty intuitive, right? You're going to where the people are that have the skills that you're looking for. And they're talking about the things that are related to the jobs that you're trying to fill and so on. Twitter has a lot of those communities and so does LinkedIn. But so does Reddit, I guess.
Reddit. Somebody listen to this, like, oh, you're talking about organic reach. Will you be on TikTok? Well, I'm experimenting with it and a few posts later and it went crazy. Right. But I think I have doubled down. I post fleets or the stories feature and I post to LinkedIn multiple times a day. If you're focused on that, that's a full day. It is a full day. And so for me, I've just decided I need to go super narrow these two platforms, which has allowed me to cultivate a network, right? I mean, there are people that have followed me on Twitter that I've admired from afar for a very long time that are starting to follow me now. Mm-hmm. And it's like, wow, because what's happened is enough of our mutual, because dev Twitter, everybody runs kind of in the same circle, right? Like you can follow pretty much like the top 10, 15 accounts, and you can start seeing who else follows them. And if you just get in that, which is another reason why Twitter is so powerful, because you can kind of find your niche within a group's perspective. And so it just kind of starts cultivating this network that you wouldn't be able to get on LinkedIn.
There's a deeper point here. Sometimes it is not as much about what you know as who you know. That is, you don't have to be the very best, most top skilled engineer in a particular craft to land a job. You do have to find that opportunity, though.
So I had a great pleasure to speak virtually at Codapalooza, Louisville's Code Conference with Chad Green. Shout out Chad, last year. And I said, he did a cool like interview one-on-one with the speakers before their sessions. And I said, you could be a terrible developer and a really good networker and still be okay in your career. Yeah. And he kind of was like, well, and I said, listen, I understand that. That's a little billboard material. But like for me, I think, Ethan, I think you make a point. I think networking is what I say, the social currency of today.
But like, engineers, the way we think, we tend to pride ourselves on our skills. These are the things that I can do.
Accomplishments.
Yeah, but do you know anybody? Can you talk to other humans? You know,
probably not.
That's a pretty big deal.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. All right, so let's say, Taylor, that I've decided I want to go with you as a recruiter. What questions should I ask you from the get-go? If I'm thinking about bringing you on as my recruiter to help me find my next job, mm-hmm. what questions do I need to ask you to make that determination?
So the initial meeting, so the first off, your initial meeting with a recruiter needs to be a Zoom call, right? So I've been very loud about this. If a recruiter isn't willing to do a Zoom call with you, move on. Right? Why in the world would you not want to meet the person who's potentially responsible for the next part of your career? Like, to me, that's ridiculous. And I'll tell you, recruiters have gotten lazy. Recruiters have really gotten lazy now because we're a year into this pandemic thing. And now they're just like having a 7-minute phone call with you and they're done. Right. I mean, it's gotten bad. And so like for me, I think first off, it's asking me, hey, Taylor, can we do a Zoom call?
Okay.
Right? Hey, Kelly, can we do a Zoom call? Hey, Zach, can we do a Zoom call? Right. Well, actually, can we just do a phone call, Ned? Nope. Can't do it. And then I wouldn't talk to them again after the Zoom call. So a few things, like the initial meeting with the recruiter needs to be more of just feeling out how they do things. Right. So like, I would love for someone to ask like, hey, how do you like, what's the process of working with you? Right. I will tell you, I'd probably send you a tech eval that we use. Shout out Brad Westfall. Questionable.io. I got to give him a plug. He's part of one of the React core training guys with Michael Jackson and all those guys. He actually was sick and tired of recruiters sending him terrible tech evals. So his side hustle was to create his own. So we use his suite. So again, that's questionable.io. But so I usually send an eval or two because I'll talk to you as much as in depth as I can. And at this point, I know, I mean, honestly, like, humble brag, I can talk to you in about 6 minutes and know if you're good or not. Like it's not rocket science at this point, but I miss sometimes. I'm not perfect. So I'll send a tech eval. Then I'll say, hey, Ned, can you give me a reference or two? Right. Cause my goal as a recruiter is when I submit you to a client, I want to have a little packet, right? We did a reference, we tested and I zoomed him. So as a client, you're like, oh, okay, cool. Well, then I just need to have a quick phone call and that's it. Right. So the initial call, ask the recruiter how they do business. Another question too, ask the recruiter how many times they should check in with you, right? Or check in with the recruiter, right? Because for me, like, just text me once a day, just text me. It's fine. Just text me. Right. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of times people don't know how to approach recruiters because they're like, oh, I've never heard back. When's the last time you checked in with them? 2 months ago? Yeah. I don't hear from my mom for 2 months if I don't check in with her, right? So it's like, you got to check in with us because of the volume, right? The volume is just right. What I try to get really loud about. For meeting that many people, we have to maintain those relationships as well. It gets a lot. So you need to check in a lot. So that's the first initial meeting. Now, there are some questions what I would ask real quick. I'll give you like a five that are really important if the recruiter sends you a job.
Okay.
Which is, this is where it gets really, really important. First thing I would ask the recruiter, one, how long have you been working with this hiring manager or how long have you been working with this company? Right. And that's really important because it shows longevity, which again is most important with recruiting, right? I'm going to have a different way of doing my business from a 10-year person as a 2-year person.
Well, wait a minute. What am I trying to avoid here? Why would I qualify the recruiter with that specific question?
Because if they say, oh, this is a new client, then you know you're going to be probably in store for some bumps. Like seriously, like I tell people, hey, Ethan, this is a brand new client. I have no idea what I'm doing. Like we're just going to figure this out together. It's expectation, right? What is the biggest issues with recruiters is there's no expectations, right? Every single call I have with a developer, I'm like, hey, you'll hear from me a little bit now. If things don't work out, I'm going to go under. You probably won't hear from me for weeks, but then I'll pop back up with a job and then you'll get an offer. So it's setting expectations.
So wait a minute. Something's key here. Your role as the recruiter is not simply match these people, then schedule an interview and hey, let me know if it worked out. There's the recruiter is responsible for more stuff.
That's what people don't understand, is that we're basically glorified admin assistants too. like there is so much, you could say project manager. I may have upset some project managers, but like just guiding, we have to guide the individual through the entire process, right? We have to make sure the individuals are lined up for phone calls. We have to call them after the phone call and debrief with them and see what they talked about to make sure nothing was said that was inappropriate or not. You know, we had sometimes managers go rogue, right? Then we set them up for the second call and maybe the third, you know what I'm saying? So there's a lot of like moving parts instead of just saying, hey, Mr. and Mrs. Manager, here's Ethan, have fun. That's not it.
Right. I'm curious because you mentioned how long have you worked with this client or with this company. Is part of that just, you can prepare me for the interview process because Correct. You understand their style of interviewing. Is that something you think is a responsibility of the recruiter is to
coach? Yes, the recruiter should prep you and give you the entire background of dealing with that manager or what's going on.
Awesome. Now, another big thing is salary negotiation. Because you're working for me, yes, the job seeker, but you're also working for the company that is potentially giving the job. So now you think about it, what is your incentive to maximize my salary when you're also working for this other company? So like, how does salary negotiation work? And sure. How am I sure that the recruiter has my best interests in mind?
Yeah, Taylor, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, get him. This is such a good question because this is a question I get a lot that I got asked a lot pre-pandemic when I spoke at conferences, is let's talk about money, recruiters and rates and things. I will tell you this. So let's break down both sides. One is the direct hire salary side of things, right? So we negotiate a fee of first year salary with the client before we even send your profile over. Okay. So if that's the case, the more you get, the more I get. Hey, there you go, right? So that's it. I mean, pretty straightforward. Now let's talk about the contract, because that's where recruiters are like jacking down rates, try to get you very low because we have a margin, right? The client gives us a bill rate. The client gives us a rate, and we have to make it make sense for the job seeker, and we have to make it business sense to make us money too from our end, right? And so I talked about this the other day. The job seeker needs to know what they're worth. I see so many times job seekers just start looking for jobs, and they're like, I'm like, hey, so what's your PTO? They're like, I don't know. How do you not know your PTO? Okay, well, then next question. 401k match? I don't know. Okay, this is going well. What is your monthly benefit cost? No idea. All right. Well, you need to go because what happens is, from an hourly perspective, my goal is to try to lump together everything and come out with one hourly rate. And I break it down with candidates where it makes sense. Mm-hmm. And basically go, okay, I got you all this. And so what we do is we try to fit that big lump number in between that rate the client gives us.
This is people that are working for a company thinking in terms of salary and not counting the fact that their healthcare is worth X and that 401k match is worth X. In other words, the total compensation package,
total comp.
That's what they need to come to the table with so that they can compare where they're at to what the offer might be.
If you work with me, and you schedule a meeting with me, I use Calendly. Shout out Calendly too. Love to get sponsored by them because they're fantastic. Yeah. I fill one of my questions you have to fill out as a job seeker is you fill out your entire comp package. Now I just started asking for it because I'm sick and tired of like getting to the end of it and people not knowing, because that's really important. I mean, shoot, I had a guy. It was like what. I'm not kidding you, like 100, 200 bucks a month and only $3,000 deductible. And I just told him, I was just like, bro, I said, that's great. I said, that's great. I said, I can't match that, but I can get you. And we walked through kind of everything together. And he ended up taking the job through me because I was able to walk through, okay, we can't get you this, but I can get you this. And then, but that's how it works from a salary and hourly perspective, which is why you need to know your entire worth to make sure you're not getting gypped on the contract portion.
Now, is there a place or some set of resources you would point someone at who's trying to assess their worth? Because they might be underpaid today and not realize it. So yeah. How do you even figure out what your market value is?
Talk to a recruiter.
Okay.
I mean, I say that. I obviously kind of say that kind of funny, but I mean, so I've had a lot of conversations with developers, and that's where recruiters really can help you. Right. So many times developers think, and not developers, job seekers, period. Right. Again, I come at everything from a developer engineering side of things, but the recruiter sees salaries in your city across the board.
True. Right.
If you ask me right now what the top end of salary is right now and the mid tier, I could tell you. And if you don't have, so many times people see a recruiter like, okay, I'll just use a recruiter to find a job and I'll be done. No. They can help you write your resume. They can help you write your LinkedIn. They can help educate you with the market. Who's hiring? Who's not hiring? Where do you want to go? Where don't you want to go? Right? We're like an Encyclopedia Britannica. I don't know if I said that right.
I think you did. Okay, going to that salary, that geographical location and stuff, how is that changing? How is your market value changing
in
the remote work world?
It's going up. Yeah. Really? I'm seeing it. Salaries. I'm starting to see salaries creep for the first time in a year. We're starting to get salaries that are 10% at least higher. It's not a ton, but like we just got a job order today. And I was like, ooh, okay. So like that was like, I'm bad at math, maybe 20%, 25% higher than usual.
Wow. To me, that's shocking because I would have thought because the employers can select from a much larger pool, the laws of supply and demand would say, well, they can now pay less because they have such a broader range of potential.
But the good
candidates.
Talent, though, let's face it, let's be honest, the good talent that most of the companies are trying to go after is still limited.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. I mean, like for me, so I had Josh Seifer. He's the QA engineering manager at Webflow, and he hopped on my live show with me, and we were talking about how like they had pay bands, and they're evaluating getting rid of pay bands because now they want to pay somebody in Montana this rate, but then Amazon's coming in and paying that person in Montana San Francisco money. Instead of Montana money. And so they're losing people because there's no pay bands for some of these larger clients. It's just a fascinating world right now. I mean, it is the Wild West. I mean, I've had three or four people just peace out on me on contract just because they either like didn't work and their performance was bad because candidates know that they don't live in that city. They don't have to worry about the reputation, or they can just bounce on a project because for a variety of reasons.
Right.
Taylor, give us some more red flags of recruiters you shouldn't work with. You gave us a couple earlier. One was, sure, if they're not going to meet with you on Zoom, nah. And another one was, if the recruiter doesn't have a lot of experience with the client they represent, that's kind of a red flag. Any more?
I mean, those are the big ones. I mean, I checked the references tab on LinkedIn. That while that isn't huge, I think it does help, right? I mean, if you have a recruiter that's got 20 recommendations versus like zero, that's a huge difference. And that's really important. That's not a must. I think the big thing is too, is just like vibe, right? Like how are you vibing with that recruiter? Are they like, hello, Mr. Ethan Banks, or is it like this, right? Is it just a hangout? Because I think a lot of times people are like, how do I judge a recruiter? I think you do it by the Zoom. I think you do it just by, you know, the other things I've talked about. But I think you also just, it has to be feel, right? Because this person could technically be with you your entire career, right? I have had people that I've worked with 10 years ago still reach out to me.
I think that actually leads me into the last question I had, which
I
is,
I love it.
You know, is the recruiter relationship useful after I got my dream job? Like, do you stay in contact with those that you've placed that you think, no, that's their forever career. They're going to be there for the next 20 years. So does it make sense to even keep talking to a recruiter or keep talking to that person?
I mean, let's face it. No one stays at companies for 20 years anymore, right? I mean, it's just, unlikely. It's not a thing. And so I think having that in the back of your mind, I mean, I think, you know, I tell my recruiting team is fairly young. And a lot of them get upset when they lose a good candidate, right? Because they care about the candidate. They want to place the candidate. They've built the relationship and the candidate goes bye-bye, right? Mm. But I tell them, I'm like, listen, you laid the groundwork. you lay the foundation of a relationship that's going to last you in 10 years, for 10 years, where you may not get them this round. You may not even get them the second or third round, but you may get them the fourth time they're looking, and then they're an engineering manager and they need 10 people. Hmm. Right. And so like, right. That's where you have to start really kind of thinking like, hey, listen, as a recruiter, we can be an individual's advocate for their entire career from here on out. Because let's face it, right? Let's say Ned, you and I work together. I place you, or you found a job on your own, but you're still open to part-time work. I get part-time work. I can send you mm-hmm. part-time work. Right. And so that's where that candidate, I tweeted this the other day. I said, I truly think a recruiter can be a cheat code for your career. A good recruiter can be a cheat code for your career.
It's very different from the way that I typically review, regard the recruiting community. And it's because I've had so much negative interaction with them, you know, throwing jobs at me for that, you know, cold fusion thing from 20 years ago or whatever it is.
Yeah.
But it changes the mindset a little bit if you do find that person who's going to be not a recruiter. And, you know, maybe that's the problem. What they really need to be is a career advocate.
That's why I changed my title. Yeah, recruiter advocate, right? I mean, I think we need to be your advocate. I think recruiters need to do better. I think we need to be people's advocate now and in the future. And you know, the great quote of Gary Vaynerchuk, right? Doing the right thing is always the right thing. And I think for me, I think as a recruiter, I think treating people with respect, I think treating people with the way they want to be treated, is the only way to do it.
That's a great note to ride out on. So if people want to get in touch with you, I know you've dropped a few things here and there. Let's summarize at the end. Where should they go out and find you, Taylor?
The easiest way, and then you can find all the other resources. The easiest way, follow me on Twitter. That's where I play the most of my day on, at T Desseyn, T-D-E-S-S-E-Y-N. And then also connect with me on LinkedIn, first name, last name. And I have a bunch of other resources, but those are the two main places.
Fantastic, Taylor. Thank you so much for being a guest today on Day 2 Cloud.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
All right. We want to thank Taylor for being a guest. And we also want to thank you, people out there on the internet. Virtual high fives to you for tuning in. You know, if you have suggestions for future shows, we'd really love to hear them. Your voice matters. So hit either of us up on Twitter at Day2CloudShow, or you can fill out the form on my fancy website, nedinthecloud.com. Hey, vendors out there. If you've got a way cool cloud product you want to share with our audience of IT professionals, why not become a Day 2 Cloud sponsor? You'll reach several thousand listeners, all of whom have problems to solve. Maybe, just maybe, your product fixes their problem, but we'll never know unless you tell them about your amazing solution. You can find out more at packetpushers.net/sponsorship. Until next time, just remember, cloud is what happens while IT is making other plans.